passage of scripture this morning, Genesis 35. If you turn there, Genesis 35. And then John chapter number 20. John 35. And then John chapter number 20. Genesis 35, and the word of God says, "And God said unto Jacob, Arise and go into Bethel and dwell there, and make there an altar unto God that appeared unto you when thou fleddest from the face of Esau, thy brother. Then Jacob said unto his household and to all that were with him, Put away the strange gods that are among you, and be clean, and change your garments. Let us arise, go up to Bethel, and I will make there an altar unto the Lord, who answered me in the day of my distress, and was with me in the way in which I went. They gave unto Jacob all the strange gods which were in their hand, and all the earrings which were in their ears, and Jacob hid them under the oak which was by Shechem." John chapter number 20, verse number 1 and 2, we're celebrating resurrection today. The Bible says, "The first day of the week cometh Mary Magdalene early, when it was yet dark, unto the sepulchre, and seeth the stone taken away from the sepulchre. Then she runneth and cometh to Simon Peter, to the other disciple whom Jesus loved, and said unto them, They have taken away the Lord out of the sepulchre, and we know not where they have laid him." It's interesting that we really aren't sure of the season. We don't know the day of the week in which Jesus was born, although our calendar revolves around that. But what we do know, Brother David, is this, is that it was on the first day of the week, amen, that he was resurrected from that grave, Brother Walt. We celebrate it in our culture and custom as Sunday, amen, the first day of the week. Yet for 3 days, each of his disciples, each one of his followers, they wondered. Now, if you would allow, I'd like to bring these two stories and bring them together. When we get to the end, I pray that we can magnify the name of Jesus and we can show you what we can do with a God that is buried. Amen, with a God that is buried. Let's first look at the first text that I read of Jacob. He is now, Jacob is now Israel. He had an encounter with God. We'll reflect on that in a moment. He had an encounter with God in which this man was changed from a supplanter to a prince with God. His name would be changed. No longer Jacob, but his name would be Israel. And so, as he's there, the Word of God says he's about to make his way to Bethel, that place, Sister Alice, where he had an encounter with God, the house of God, Bethel, that place of God. And so he is looking to take his family and everyone who is with him to that place called Bethel. And I can imagine he rises up early in the morning. There he is. He's walking. He's holding his hip. He has wrestled with God. He would not let go of the encounter with God until God touched him. And he was blessed by God. So he's feeling the ache of the hip. He's feeling the pain of the hip. Some of you know what that's like. Maybe it's a hip. Maybe it's a knee. Maybe it's a whatever. But you know, those. But his wasn't because of age or because of disease. His was because God had touched him. And so here he is, he's looking around, and he's reflecting on that encounter with God. Don't sometimes we have to reflect on our encounters with God, where we wrestled with God, where we prayed with God? Life is tough, amen. We need to remember those moments that we have with God. They will preserve us, they will keep us, they will encourage us. And as he's reflecting, he begins to look around, Sister Dietrich, and he sees his servant's house, and he looks at the tent, and there's some superstitious paraphernalia that is hanging up there. And he looks at his children and at his grandchildren, and he realizes that they've become accustomed to all the pagan ways, and they have all kinds of relics that really mean nothing. He looks at their earrings, he looks at their jewelry, and they're engraved. engraved with images of gods or maybe words to a God that is far beyond the God that he wrestled with. And as he looks around, he's rubbing his head. Amen. This man remembers a time when he was a supplanter. He was the second born twin. And he was a heel grabber. He was a deceiver. Until God changed all of that, all of the supplanting. It broke away into supplication when he talked with God and God worked in his life. You know what? God loves to take supplanters. People that are deceivers, people that their lives are mixed up, and he likes to take all that and change it. Amen. Change it to prayer, to victory. Amen. To a place where men and women are touched by God and their walk is different. How well he remembered that night. I became a prince with God. Maybe he looks at an urn, if you will, that is full of bones of his wife. And he says, you know, the prayers to those gods couldn't do anything for her. The prayers to God changes things. I feel the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
I said, prayers to God changes things. So how it was for him, he began to go to his servants, and he said, I need to take these relics and paraphernalia down. He goes to his granddaughters, and he says, I need to take the relic away. I know that you've looked at it, you've prayed to it, you've hoped in it, but we're going back to Bethel. We can't allow the stuff. We're going back to meet with God. Let me just tell you, paraphernalia can build up in our life. Amen. Things can build up in our life that can distract us from the living God, the true God. Amen. It's time sometimes we just get rid of the paraphernalia and we bury it. So here he is. The Bible says that he gets all this paraphernalia, Brother Aaron, and he takes it to Shechem and he digs a hole and he buries it there. And as he buries it there, he knows that he's making his way to Bethel. Amen. A place where a golden ladder was and angels ascending and descending, a gateway to heaven, the dwelling place of God. Amen. He knew that he was going to have to do something. So he gets all their gods, their idols, their earrings, their icons, their pagan symbols, and he buries them. What it must have been like for those, Sister Tina, who believed in those. I believed in that. I hoped in that. I prayed to that. And now it's gone. And it's buried. What will we do with a buried God? Could I change gears and can we jump to this morning our text in the book of John? I'm reminded of a time hundreds of years later when before sunrise, journey with me this morning, please journey with me. And then I really want the Lord to help us. Mary Magdalene, as the sun's rising, she hurriedly made her way to a graveyard. She came not in the hopes of relics, or not to worship a dead God, not to give seances to the departed, but she simply came to see what do we do with a buried God. And as she came to the Lord's tomb, she saw that the stone was rolled back. And the body of Jesus was missing. Amen. He is God. He is God. What did they do with a dead God? He is God. And immediately she runs to the disciples and she says, our God is God. What have they done with him? Can I now all of a sudden jump back a little bit? Can I paint a picture of everything that's happening? Here is Mary Magdalene. She's been to the place called Calvary. I want to ask you, how do you see Calvary this morning? I'd like to paint a picture of Calvary for you. And then I'd like to take a trip by an empty tomb and look what we do with a buried God. But let's go to Calvary this morning. Amen. Can you imagine that right there in Calvary, here it is that Jesus is hanging on a tree. Amen. Christ, he is the one being crucified. They released the criminal. Amen. And here it is. His back is tortured. His knees are bleeding because he fell beneath the cross that he was carrying. reed is placed into his shaking hand. A crown of thorns is upon his head. It's interesting this morning, after church, you'd like to see. There is actually a crown of thorns that I've laid out on the table here. They come from the Holy Lands. And so it's symbolic and similar to that which was placed on Jesus' head. Very long thorns placed down upon his brow, into his skull. Can you imagine that there it was, thorns upon his head? Think about that for a moment. Think about, where did thorns come from? This world knew no thorns until the fall of Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden. And all of a sudden, thorns begin to grow. Amen. And if we're not careful in our life, thorns of doubt, despair, and hopelessness can grow wildly. But oh, thank God. Amen. He took the curse of sin. Amen. Upon himself, as the crown of thorns was placed upon his head. He is the King. Amen. He is the Victor. He's my King. Hallelujah. Jesus wore the curse. He who knew no sin became sin. Amen. Look upon his shaking shoulders. There is a cross. He goes down the Via Dolorosa carrying it. He falls beneath it. And there's a man that's black in collar, a Simon Cyrene, that is asked to take up the cross and carry it for him. I want you to know that every one of us in life are called to bear crosses. Oh, every one of us in life are called to bear crosses. Simon bore Jesus' cross. Sometimes it's crosses that God has ordained. Sometimes it's crosses that we've self-inflicted ourselves with. But God gives grace for the cross. Rusty spikes were driven through his hands. His feet possibly turned sideways. A nail was driven through his feet. There among two thieves, he hung. He uttered his final words. And there upon a cursed tree, he purchased our redemption. Oh, what a Savior. Oh, what a Savior. Some would say that Calvary, and I remember as a child sitting in church, and I would draw sometimes, Brother Dennis, and I'd draw a hill in the middle and two at the side. And there would be crosses. That middle cross, Brother David, would be a little bit higher because the hill was extended. But that's really not what Calvary's picture looked like. If you really look at Calvary, it was crosses hung at the base of the hill. Three of them. And behind the hill was a rocky cliff. In fact, the cliff, Sister Rachel, looked like it was in the shape of a skull. It was a reminder. They led him through the most crowded areas, down streets where there was lots of people, because the Romans wanted to put fear in others. See, the cross was a terrible thing. And there it was on Calvary that he took and purchased our ticket to redemption. You see, you and I were in Satan's pawn shop, and he was trying to sell us for a mere wage. He had us bound, but God said, I will purchase their redemption. And so with the cross of Calvary, he bought the ticket, Brother Aaron, that would purchase you and I. Amen. For the pawn shop of the enemy. Thank God for the cross. Listen to this. Three guys were tried for crimes against humanity. Two guys committed crimes, but one didn't. Three guys were given government trials. Two guys had fair trials, and one didn't. Three guys were whipped and beaten. Two guys had it coming, but one didn't. Three guys were given crosses to carry. Two guys earned their crosses, one guy didn't. Three guys were mocked and spit upon along the way. Two guys cursed and spit back, but one guy didn't. Three guys were nailed to crosses. Two guys deserved it, one guy didn't. Three guys agonized over their abandonment. Two guys had a reason to be abandoned, one man didn't. Three guys talked while hanging on their crosses. Two guys argued, one guy didn't. Three guys knew death was coming. Two guys resisted, but one did. One, two, three guys died on crosses. 3 days later, two guys remained in their tomb, but one guy didn't. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. He is alive. That's how I see Calvary. Amen. A glorious prelude. Amen. To an amazing, victorious resurrection. Amen. In hindsight, amen. I want to ask Mary Magdalene, Peter, what do you do with a buried God? You know, Jacob, he buried the gods of his family. Amen. Somewhere along the line, as they were journeying to Bethel, they were probably thinking, oh, they'll come and they'll find us. Or they'll see where we are. But they didn't. They remained under some tree. Amen. Where Jacob had buried them. Yeah. What do we do when confronted by a buried God? I believe that we just be still. Because he won't. What's your situation? Amen. God look dead. Amen. Be still because he won't. Be still and know that he is God. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. And all things were made by him, and without him was nothing made. In him was life, and the life was a light of men. Amen. Here it is. A lifeless deity's buried in Shechem. Amen. But when you bury Jesus in a borrowed tomb, he will not lay there lifeless because all life is in him. Be still and know that he is God. The resurrection of Jesus is more than just a story. There's a motive behind his resurrection. He stepped into darkness to bring us life. He stepped into hopelessness to bring us hope. Amen. He does the work that we cannot. Amen. Be still and know that he is God. And God is at work. Amen. Mary Magdalene, be still. You don't need to run. You don't need to share with anybody else. You come, amen, to the place where God is buried. What are you going to do? The grave is empty. The best advice, and I don't criticize her. I would have probably done the same thing. But the best case scenario was be still and know that he is at work. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Listen, I feel the Holy Ghost this morning. And I am prophetically speaking, be still and let God work. Amen. The second thing, not just be still because he won't be, but believe and watch him make a way. Can you imagine maybe some little girl that was like a baby doll, Brother Terry? She thought that this was a God. She prayed to it. She stood me every night, she went to bed, but that little baby doll was her God. So she probably thought, Sister Dietrich, this God will come and find me. But that God remained underneath a tree, buried. They have ears, but they cannot hear. They have eyes, and they see not. Buried gods can't find a way to the forest of humanity's problems. But a victorious God, who is living, can find his way to every situation that you and I will have to face. Their arms, they can't remove the weight of loneliness and greed and selfishness. They can't relieve the burden of depression or sickness or pain. The weight of it all keeps them immobilized. Yet there is one who bore all pain. There is one who took all sorrow. Keep looking. You'll find him. Mary, do you hear something? Mary, do you hear a stirring, a trembling? Amen. Someone is coming for you. Someone has seen your tears. Mary, I want you to believe and watch. He will make a way. What do we do with a dead God? Amen. Why don't you just believe and watch? Because he's about to come by and move in your situation, Mary. Keep looking. He will find you. He will find you. I love as he speaks, Mary. Mary. She's supposing him to be the carpenter. Tell me. Tell me. What have you done with my Lord? Just tell me where's he at. Please. Please. Listen. Sometimes we have to know that we do not serve a buried dead God. We do not have to seek Him in disillusionment, but we can know that as we seek Him, He will find us in resurrection power. Amen. When you feel unlovable, He still loves you. Amen. When you feel lonely, He still desires a close relationship with you. When you feel like you're in despair, all hope is lost. Amen. He comes by to restore and renew hope. God is alive this morning. I'm not worshiping some God buried underneath a tree who can't see or hear or know or touch or feel, but I serve a resurrected Savior who knows everything about me and seeks me and finds me and is resurrected in power just for me. Hallelujah, we serve a living God this morning. Probably one of the most profound stories that I've ever heard besides the Bible at Easter is about a little boy named Philip. I know I've told the story many years, many times. And maybe it's so dear to my heart because of my friend Andrew. But Philip was different than all the other kids. One day his teachers at Sunday school, Brother David, took him outside to find something that represented Easter. And as the teacher took him out, they all got little things and they put inside an egg that she had given them. They brought them back in with the class and they began to display them. Brother Aaron, one had a flower representing new life, and one, Sister Susan, had a rock representing the stone that was rolled away. When they got to Philip, Philip opened his egg. It was empty. The class began to laugh. He said, "My egg is empty because the tomb is empty. The tomb is empty that we may be full." Hallelujah. I said, "The tomb is empty that we may be full." The tomb is empty because it brings validation to an atoning work upon the cross. Amen. He is alive. Amen. Sister, I don't know if you're able to come and just do anything on the piano or not. Amen. It's all right. If you're a little extra bad, don't worry about it. It's okay. Amen. But what I do want you to worry about is the presence and the Spirit of God this morning. I'm closing quickly. I want you to know something this morning. We serve, come on, Bella, come on, come on, you know. We serve a living Savior. Sister Susan, what do you do with a buried God?
Israel knew because of his experience with God. He knew who God was. Listen, in this sanctuary, you know who God is. Even when life has clouded things out, you still know who God is. He's alive. We've not buried Him in some tomb and He's there. We come to worship Him like Muhammad or Princess Diana or Elvis and some hopeless type of desire that we want them to come back, because they're never coming back. They're not God. But Brother Josh, the one that we've come to worship here today, amen, is the same God who's touched us in our walk. Would you rub your hip this morning and realize that that same God who's touched you in the past is the same God who can touch you and help you today? Amen. What do we do with a buried God? Why don't we just stand still, amen, and watch God come forth in life? Amen. Why don't we believe that He's going to come to us? Amen. Trust Him this morning that He keeps every word. He is alive. I don't know your needs, but God does. And this Easter, I want to tell you, that no matter what you face, no matter what you're going through, we don't come to a dead God. Our brother Elam, we come to a God that's alive. Stand still. I believe I hear some stirring. And I believe I hear a Savior whispering your name. You've come to see me, but you won't find the living among the dead. I'm here in resurrection. With that said, come, find a place at the altar. Whatever your need is, whatever your situation, come and present it to a living God. He loves you this morning. Would you get ready? We serve a living God. Amen. What will I do with a dead God? Amen. My God's not dead. I will watch him in resurrection power. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Lord, I love you. I worship you. Hallelujah. 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 Let him move in resurrection power in your life. Hallelujah. In your situation. Thank you.
Hallelujah.